It's time for The Car Doctor on AM 950 WROL. Got a car question? Call us at 617-770-3030. That's 617-770-3030. Now, here's The Car Doctor, John Paul, on AM 950 WROL, the spirit of Boston.
And good Saturday morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL, the spirit of Boston, 100.3 FM, or the WROL app, or online, wrolradio.com. Our phone number is 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. I want to thank Joe Ligotti for having me on his program this past Wednesday, and I think the segment just aired this in the last half hour here on WROL, and that's something we're going to try to do on a regular basis. We're going to try to do it every Wednesday around 5:15 on his program, so tune into that. And then we're at, I think next Saturday, we're going to try to have Joe on the show just to introduce my radio family to him. So if you don't listen to him, you'll get an idea of what he's all about. We'll just chit-chat a little bit for a few minutes with him next week. Other than that, I'm still, well, I guess you could call it vacation. I'm not at work, so it must be vacation, right? And although it doesn't feel like it sometimes. But if you want to call us, everything should work the way it's supposed to. And the phone number again is 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. And call in and talk about whatever's on your mind about cars and car problems. If you were here just now, where I am, you would have noticed I just spilled my coffee. Comment, Dennis?
Hey, you know, you start playing, you start taking your mind off this game, and guess what happens?
Things. I know, that's what happens. That's what happens. I was just looking for an article to read, and only because the headline really caught my attention, and that's the Ram pickup truck with the new diesel. This is the heavy-duty Ram truck, which I saw at the Boston Auto Show. It has 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. Now, that's a ridiculous, that's tractor-trailer sort of torque. So the new top-of-the-line Ram 3500 will offer an engine that's rated at 1,000 foot-pounds of torque, an industry first. It's capable of towing, I think, 35,000 pounds of towing. It has 35,000 pounds of towing capacity. The diesel pickup torque tug of war being waged against Detroit's truck brands launches into 2019 with a change at the top of the leaderboard. The re-engineered Ram heavy duty 3500 arriving soon at dealerships. I think it's actually really soon. Is able to crank out 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. The torque figure is not a PR or marketing gimmick, although the figure will no doubt feature prominently in ads. It's an important measurement. Buyers who tow heavy things. Ed Kim, Auto Pacific's Vice President of Industry Analysis, says retail customers of heavy-duty trucks are attracted to the ability to haul massive amounts of stuff. They also like to have bragging rights of the most powerful truck engine, although retail customers in the segment are more loyal. They're comparing specs, and even if they may not admit off the bat, they're willing to consider shopping between brands. I mean, it really is. I mean, people are Ford people, Ram people, Chevy, GMC people, and then somewhere in there is Toyota and Nissan. But Ram says the 2019 3500 with the high output Cummins engine can tow a maximum of 35,100 pounds, which is a huge amount. I mean, that is tractor trailer towing ability just about. So if you're somebody who has a big cargo trailer, a big camping trailer, and you really want to do it without having to look at, you know, oh, I have a big hill coming up, I need to speed up to get up that big hill. You know, I don't think you're going to have to do it with this. Ram, which has used the Cummins built inline six in its heavy-duty trucks for 30 years, edges out Ford's 6.7-liter Powerstroke V8 diesel, which has a torque rating of 935 foot-pounds, which is still an incredible amount. When it comes to horsepower, which is more closely related, Yeah, it doesn't do quite as well, but horsepower isn't about towing. Horsepower is about getting up to speed, and that's where sometimes it gets a little bit confusing. But the horsepower of this truck is, when it first, it's kind of funny, when it first came out, the original, in 1989, I remember driving one of the first Cummins diesel pickup trucks in 1989. I thought it was huge because it was also a dually diesel, so it was one of the first dually trucks I've ever driven. And it was only 160 horsepower, but it was 400 foot-pounds of torque. And it happened to be a manual transmission, which was even weirder. And it was also kind of interesting, if you've never driven a standard shift car before, driving a vehicle with 400 foot-pounds of torque, you can't really stall it. You can take your foot off the clutch, no stalling problems. So, Dennis, if you're not, if you weren't a stick shift aficionado, you could easily drive one of these old Ram trucks with a stick shift because it was pretty easy to do. Then in 2001, they did a little bit more work. They introduced a high output Cummins engine, and that had 235 horsepower and about 500 foot pounds of torque. 2011, it went up to 800 foot-pounds of torque. Still, horsepower numbers are low at 350. 2016, it went up to 385. And then in 2019, it went up to 400 horsepower, but a crazy 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. So we'll have to wait and see what that turns into, and see if more and more cars are going that way. So we'll wait and find out. There is, at the auto show in Detroit, Lexus unveiled a LC convertible concept, which I think is going to come out. And it's convertibles are sort of funny. They were really popular for a while, then they completely went away. Well, way back when, you know, in the 70s, and that had to do with rollover. They couldn't meet the roof crush standards. Then they came back, and they did pretty well. And then they sort of went away. So it's a little bit harder to buy a convertible. In fact, the New England Motor Press, we do this thing called the Ragtop Ramble, which is where we used to get the convertibles from all manufacturers. We would bring them to one location. The last bunch of years has been at the Lars Anderson Auto Museum in Brookline. And then we'd take a leisurely drive up to Kennebunkport, Maine, have lobster, and then turn around and drive home. And sometimes we'd stop at the Wells Auto Museum, see the Gould Family Auto Museum up in Wells, Maine. And back then, we had 20 or 25 convertibles because every manufacturer had some sort of a convertible. But it's not so much anymore. In fact, you kind of look around and you look and it was kind of funny. I was somewhere and I saw a Buick Riata convertible. And the Buick Riata was kind of an interesting little car. It was very simple engine inside. It was a 3.8-liter V6, but it had a true CRT tube display. So it had a regular old-fashioned picture tube display, which, like all picture tubes, eventually didn't work anymore. So instead of the touch screen that we see today. And it was, in the end, when they came out with the convertible and they kind of redid the suspension a little bit, it wasn't a bad little car. And like many times, And George Kennedy and I were talking about this at the Boston Auto Show. GM seems to do a really good job of finalizing a car and then doing away with it. So the Pontiac Fiero was one of those. The Fiero, in its last iteration with a little bit of fastback with the V6 engine, it was a pretty neat little car. Buick Riata was the same thing. So less and less convertibles, although they're still out there and Volkswagen is going to do away with the Beetle. So the Beetles, this is the last year for the Beetle. And it is, so there goes the convertible. Although I heard back several years ago, Volkswagen's going to come out with a Jetta-based convertible. So sort of a lower, kind of lower version of the Eos convertible, which they did away with. So the Eos convertible, very complicated hardtop, great car, but maybe a soft top version of the Jetta might be in the offing. And you know, they did that as kind of a retro look. So we'll have to see. And we'll have to see what's going on with convertibles these days. But if you kind of look through the lineup, starting with Acura, you're not going to see a lot of Acura convertibles, except, I suppose, if they come out with a removable roof NSX. And then you kind of go to, what's available. BMW has a convertible. Chrysler, very limited production of, but back at one point in time, Chrysler had its Sebring convertible. It had a Maserati-inspired convertible. So it had the Maserati engine, sort of, in a convertible. So there was some convertibles around. And then you sort of looked at GM. GM still has the Corvette convertible, the Camaro convertible. But they also used to have, remember, they had the Pontiac Sunbird convertible. There was a Cavalier-style convertible. There was a bunch of very affordable little convertibles, which there really are not anymore. And same thing with Ford when Ford was building cars. And as they claim, they're not going to build cars anymore, except for maybe the Focus, a version of the Focus, not the Focus we know today, but a version of the Focus in the Mustang. There'll still be a Mustang convertible. But as more and more manufacturers are going to SUVs, there goes the convertible. So they're off, and who knows what's going to happen.
Well, there's always the Jeep.
Yes, that's right. The Jeep is one of those cars that is sort of a convertible. You know, during our Ragtop Ramble, the Jeep people always send a Jeep because they're like, it's definitely a convertible. It's not the easiest to operate, although Jeep did come out with a new, much easier to use soft top in their Jeep now. So that makes it kind of nice. And people love Jeep. One of those things that in its basic form, like a Wrangler, you're it's one of those vehicles much better off buying it new than used. And the smart money people, whoever they are, certainly not me, but the smart money people will tell you that you should always buy a one-year-old used car, maybe a certified used car, because you'll let somebody else take the depreciation off of it. With a Jeep, they don't depreciate. You're better off buying it new, get the full warranty, get everything you need for it, and because you try to buy one that's 1 or 2 or 3 years old, and they're ridiculous amounts of money, and if depending on what you want to buy, you can buy a pretty basic Jeep that's still pretty affordable, and like you pointed out, Dennis, it's still a convertible. I was flipping through some magazines this morning, and I flipped through, it was Road and Track or one of those, and I saw the ad for Harbor Freight and Rock Auto, and Rock Auto still, if you're a do-it-yourselfer or even a shop owner, and you're having trouble finding parts, and this isn't an advertisement. In fact, we had the owner of Rock Auto on the program a couple of years ago, and you can get name brand parts pretty inexpensively, relatively speaking. But you can get some pretty good parts. And I had a woman call me not that long ago, and she brought her car into the Ford dealership because she had a problem with the car. And Ford said, well, the part's on a national back order. We're not going to be able to get it. It's going to be a while. She went to her independent mechanic. Her independent repair shop kind of said the same thing. Ford can't get it. We can't get it. I checked with Rock Auto on their website. They had the part in stock in different manufacturers, including the Ford part, and they could get it to her with the overnight shipping. They could get it to her the next day. So I said to her, well, talk to your independent repair shop and tell them to go order it this way, and A, you're going to get your car fixed right away, and B, you're going to save yourself some money. So something to think about. Our phone number, phone lines are open, by the way. It's 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. We touched on this last week, but this was something I've been thinking about for a while. Consumers' monthly payment amounts are climbing to dangerous heights as vehicle transaction prices and interest rates continue to rise. And this is according to Cox Automotive. The average new vehicle payment last year, $533 per month. Yeeks. $533 a month, exceeded 10.2% of the median household income in the U.S. Jonathan Smoke, chief economist for Cox Automotive, told reporters here that new vehicle monthly payments of more than $600 are alarming, and they're driving up the average. Americans can't afford to spend 10% of their total transportation. Smoke said, if it's more than 10% to buy a single vehicle, how do you handle the average two vehicles per household? Last year, 46% of new vehicles were sold with monthly payments of more than $500, according to data from DealerTrack, a Cox Automotive company. The rise in monthly payments comes as new vehicle buyers flock to the SUV and truck market, and the share of new vehicles sold at lower prices, price points, declines rapidly. There's no question affordability influences things. It corresponds to a massive shift that we've seen in the types of vehicles being sold. According to Smoke, shifts in consumer preference from sedans to crossovers and trucks drove the market of new vehicle transactions under $30,000 in 2018. Market share at the price point dropped to 34% last year. In 2012, nearly half of the new vehicle sales were sold at that amount. I remember, I guess I'm old enough to remember, when they came up with a luxury tax, the luxury tax kicked in at $32,000. Now they're saying, you know, the average transaction price is, you know, in the $30,000 range. Vehicles priced under $20,000 are almost disappearing. Their market share dropped to 2% in 2018 from 7% in 2012. Meanwhile, vehicles priced at $50,000 and above rose to 23% of new vehicle sales market last year, compared with 6% in 2012. Less than 5 years after, you know, so that's a big chunk of people's income to be able to look at that. So, I was talking about Ford a minute ago. Ford plans to launch a 300-mile range battery electric crossover inspired by the Mustang. What does that mean? So you get a crossover vehicle that looks like a Mustang? It's part of a broader electrification plan in which Ford will spend $11 billion, that's with a B, on the technology by 2012 to introduce 40 electrified vehicles globally within that time. That includes 16 fully electric vehicles and 24 hybrids or built-in or plug-in hybrids. Ford in late 2017 created a dedicated team dubbed Team Edison to study EVs. It's not a question of when, it's how fast, according to Hao Tai Tang said of the technology's adoption. Certainly we have to do our work to build the demand and educate our consumers and drive down the cost. Again, if you're looking at you know, things like the Chevy Bolt, it's a $40,000 vehicle. You know, that's a pretty significant chunk of people's income. And you say, well, we're going to build these electric cars, and if there's no tax incentives, if you have the ability to do that. I guess I wasn't aware that Hao Tai Tang had to do with technology that way. He was kind of an interesting guy. He was I remember interviewing him way back when he was on our program, and he was the head of Ford SVT, the special vehicle team, way back then. And it was a I said to him, you know,
hey,
how
sorry.
Did you...
I hate to... What is going on over there? I hear clang, bang, boom. All...
Clanging, banging in the background? I don't know what... I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. I don't know. It's all kinds of stuff going on in the background. Sorry about that. We'll have to go to the sound... We'll have to go to the soundproof studio. I could go up to my tool shed.
There you go.
Yeah, I could do that.
Wrong
maybe.
There.
Who knows? Stuff could fall off the walls. Anyway, so we'll tell the studio audience to keep quiet. I have a studio audience, you know.
Really?
Yeah. Not really. Hao Tai Tang. He's Vietnamese, and I said to him, "How you know you?" You were on the Ford Mustang design team, and he said when he was a kid and he lived in Vietnam, he remembers seeing the Ford Mustang, and he absolutely fell in love with it. And when he was just a kid, when he was 10 or 12 years old, he said, I want to go to work for Ford Motor Company. And he came to the United States and went to college and ended up in the Ford design team. And now apparently he has I'm not sure what he does at Ford these days, but he is all about the Ford electrification, and you know they're gonna try to build demand on those things. So you know, GM and Tesla both have hit their 200 unit plug-in sales targets, at which the federal EV tax credits begin to phase out. Ford is around 110,000. Ford had some pretty good, you know, Ford had the little C-Max, which nobody knew about because Ford didn't tell anybody about it. And it was a pretty good little vehicle. And the Fusion plug-in hybrid, and Dennis had a Fusion hybrid, and you liked it, right? Yeah, Dennis liked his hybrid. So there's that.
Yes, I love my hybrid. I was answering the phone. Sorry.
Yep, that's all right. That's what you're supposed to do. So, but you know, they could. You know, Ford is around 110,000 users and can presumably offer the $7,500 credit to consumers when the Mustang-inspired crossover debuts, because they haven't sold enough of their own vehicles yet. So, Mustang-inspired crossover. I just see a bad drawing there somewhere, but. We'll have to wait and see. And our phone number is 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. If you have a question about cars, car problems, I don't know, whatever's on your mind, automotive advice. I'm not that great with relationship advice, but although I told Joe Ligotti I was, so maybe. Let's talk to Tom. Tom, good morning.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, John. How you doing? Hey, John, last week you had a caller, the guy who has the, you know, classic Ford, and he was having problems with it. Well, that's his carburetor flooding all the time was the same thing that I was talking to you about mine back in December, and I have a Jeep. But he mentioned he had an Autolite carburetor, and that's what they put on the Jeeps, the Motorcraft, basically. I think Motorcraft Autolite. And I had the same, you know, got to be pretty much the same design, because mine's a 74, I think it was a 69 or something. But when you said the fuel pump, that's what it was. I had my carburetor off 6-7 times, checking this, checking that, nothing wrong. When I finally changed the fuel pump, that solved the problem.
Uh-huh.
What I would tell them to do is put an inline clear filter, one of those plastic ones like I have.
Yeah.
Just do that first. Then run the car, and then if he notices in a day or two, like it's full, when he starts up and runs it for an hour, it'll be full. And if that's draining back, and you can see where it's lost gas, it's drained back, that's the problem. That's what my problem was. And once I put a new fuel pump in, it stayed up there, and I never had the flooding problem again.
Uh-huh.
So, just something for him to try for the $30 of a pump. And I know he said that he replaced his pump a year or two ago, but I still would give it a try. That's my opinion.
Well, you know, can't
you said
can't
that
hurt.
To him right away. You know, that was the first thing you said. And the next thing, John, I see all these ads, electric cars, 100 miles to this. How do you compare the cost of a gallon of gas with the miles they get to electric? I just cannot understand it. Not that
well. Bad. Yeah, I don't think I'm that smart either, but you know, you have to look at the cost per kilowatt hour, and you know, the cost per kilowatt hour is a little bit fuzzy math, because
that's right.
Yeah, because you know, the cost per kilowatt hour, and I don't know what it is, you know, 15 or 16 cents. But the problem is when you add in all the other fees, it goes up pretty high. But still, if you're where it becomes a challenge, if you're going to go out and buy a $45,000 Chevy Bolt, and even if you looked at the cost of operation as pennies per mile, the equivalent car is half that price.
So put the cost of the vehicle into the equation, you're saying?
Right, yeah. I mean, it'd be one thing if you were going to, if you could go out and buy an electric, I don't know, Ford Mustang, and a regular Ford Mustang, and you said they both cost the same amount of money.
Right,
it would be it would be certainly be cheaper to buy the electric one. The problem is, it isn't going to be the same amount of money. It's going to be, you know, 40% more expensive.
Sure.
And you would have to keep that car forever to get your money's worth out of it. So you have to decide. You know, my old boss, who, you know, is, you know, retired and pretty well off, bought two Model 3 Teslas. So they were, I don't know, say they were $50,000 a piece. But he bought them because he also wanted the $15,000 worth of tax deductions that he could get by buying the two cars. And he likes what, and he likes the performance of an electric car. Not everybody's in that market. And the same thing with the Model 3 Tesla. It's one thing when they said it was going to be a $30,000 car. So, and it's sort of like a Camry. It feels a little like a Camry inside. You know, it's one thing, and then it's another thing when it's a $50,000 car, and, you know, you have to, you know, and there's, with the Model 3, there's no free charging, so, you know, if you do charge it up, you're charging it up at home, or you're paying so much, you know, per kilowatt hour. You know, we have a charging station at work. The first 2 hours are free, and then after that, it's a couple bucks an hour. So, on the rare occasion where I drive an electric car that has maybe 150-mile range, I drive to, you know, drive it around a little bit, drive to work, plug it in, and it might take 6 hours to charge it up. Well, that's going to be, you know, that's going to be $4 to charge it up. Well, for $4, I could buy a gallon and a half of gas, I guess, and I could drive, you know, my, even my little SUV, I could drive, you know, 45 miles. So, which is, you know, which is, you know, probably close to what that is. So you have to like kind of do the math. But, you know, most people who buy electric cars are buying them because they're a little bit of a novelty. They buy the first of everything that comes out. You know, they're the ones that bought the Apple Watch. They're the ones that bought the first iPhones. You know, those are kind of the early adopters of that sort of stuff, and that's why they buy them.
Right, but I'm watching a program on there. They have certain roads now. I forget what they call them, EV roads. You know, expressways across the country, and then they're setting all these stations in. But you're traveling. What are you going to do? I mean, sit there for hours to charge up? I mean, well, sitting down in Florida or something. You know.
Well, eventually, I mean, with some of those systems like the Tesla and some of the other ones, you can get about a 70% charge in 20 minutes. So it's not too bad. So, but still, you know, by the time you stop at the charging station, you know, get a snack, use the bathroom, you know, whatever, you know, so you're still killing time. You're still, you know, you're still looking for something to do for a few minutes. You know, there's sometimes where I go to there's this one gas station near my house, and it seems like it has the slowest pumps in the world. And, you know, I turn the pump on, and I'm kind of walking around the car. I'm cleaning the windshield. I'm looking for stuff. And, you know, it's probably taken 3 or 4 minutes, and it seems like it's taken too long. So eventually there will be, you know, and long after I'm dead, there might be highways that actually charge the car up while you drive over them. You never know.
Well, that's what needs to be done. That's key, I think, to everything there. But I just still don't get when I watch these programs and they take an electric car and they, you know, they give you the formula and it says, you know, it's 100 miles to the gallon. I just don't understand. I've never seen anybody lay out that formula. I mean, even a kilowatt, but...
I did it once. I did it once for my boss. He said, you know, how do these electric cars make any sense? So I sat down and you know, took out my high school math skills and figured out how much per kilowatt hour, figured out how big the battery was in the car, because that's going to tell you how much range you get out of it. And then tried to do the math, and then I tried to compare it to the exact, as easy as you could, to the exact equivalent car. It's one thing to compare, you know, if you compare it to, say, even a Toyota Prius that gets 50 miles per gallon. And I like the Prius a lot because I think it's where it's a hatchback, it's roomy, and you can kind of abuse it as far as space-wise. But it's not, you know, it's more equivalent to a Toyota Corolla than a Camry. So, but it's priced more like a Camry than it is like a Corolla. So you have to kind of look at all of it and determine how much you want to buy. It's when gas prices go up and people say to me, "I want to get a car that gets better gas mileage," and I'm like, "Okay, what kind of car do you have now?" And they'll have a Ford Fusion, and they said, "I said, what are they offering you for a trade-in?" Well, $10,000. And I said, "What are you going to buy?" Well, I'm going to buy, Toyota Prius. I said, well, how much is that? Well, it's $28,000. Right. And I'm like, you know, for $18,000, you can buy a lot of gas.
That's right.
And, you know, people don't always think about that, you know, so.
Right.
So you have to look at you know what you have, what you want to do, and you know where you want to go from there.
Yeah, I think the real problem is that practicality just can't be 100% unless you're going to drive, you know, something
right.
so basic.
Right.
You know, I mean, and it's
right.
just not there today. Because like you mentioned earlier, that article you read about, you know, the cost of what people
yeah.
are putting out for payments. And that's why I said when I went to car show, that's what I noticed, how cars were just very expensive.
Yeah.
I think another kicker on that, even if you were to buy the car, it's the excise tax.
Oh,
which
yeah.
is really another kick in the face, you know? Think about
yeah,
it. You bought a $40,000 car.
Yeah, that first year you get whacked pretty hard with the excise tax. And it's funny, I don't know the particulars in... But in Rhode Island, there's something called car tax, which you're trying to eliminate. And I know more people that keep older cars in Rhode Island because they don't want to pay the expensive car tax that they claim they're
right.
going to phase out. But, you know, but I
that's
don't,
what I
don't
mean.
Know.
That new
yeah.
car purchase, big sales
yep.
tax, then you get hit with a big excise tax
yep.
for several years. And that's real
yep.
money. That could be $700, $800
yep.
bucks.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah, it's funny watching... Watching people walk around the auto show and have sticker shock. I remember it reminds me of the time I was at the supermarket, which I very rarely ever go to, when there was a guy wandering around the supermarket, and apparently he had been to the supermarket less often than I have, and he's like, I can't believe how expensive everything is in the supermarket. And it's the same thing if you haven't been car shopping in 10 or 12 years and you go, you know, like I said earlier, you know, I remember when the luxury tax kicked in at $32,000 and now that's, you know, people go,
yeah,
hey, it was only a $32,000 car and that used to be luxury tax.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah.
Well, yeah, I guess that's what it is.
But... All right, someday we'll both have the answers, Tom.
Yeah, all right, enjoy your time
all
in
right.
Florida, John. You
all right.
deserve
thanks.
It. You're a hard worker.
Right.
Take care.
All right, thanks. Bye-bye. 617-770-3030, 617.
Can I interject something, too?
Pardon me?
Can I interject something, too, on that conversation?
You can interject whenever you like.
All right, so do...
You are part of the show, you know.
I understand. Yeah. But do the electric cars need to get oil changes and stuff?
No, there's not a lot of maintenance involved in an oil change. Occasionally, they might have a transmission service that needs to be done because they have a lubricated transmission, but it's pretty well sealed, so it's not like it gets contaminated and the fluid breaks down. So, and the same thing, there is a cooling system, but again, it's very, very, you know, but no real oil change. Hybrids, on the other hand, do need their oil change
right.
periodically.
Also, there's now, like, a lot of cities, like, a lot of big cities, Boston being one of them, are talking about congestion taxing.
Yeah.
And a lot of cities will be like, well, if you have a electric vehicle, then we won't tax you on that. So that's something else as well.
Yeah, they haven't figured out yet. It's congestion pricing. They're trying to establish that in Manhattan now. So if you what they're doing is they just want to keep cars out of Manhattan. So they're saying, you know, and they're not even opening up to electric and EVs. They're just trying to say stay out.
Yep.
So they want to have basically tolls going in and out of the city that will charge you a ridiculous amount of money so you don't take your car in the city, which to me bothers me a lot. Because it means that people with a ton of money are still going to go, I don't care how much it costs to bring my car in the city. And working people that have to try to get into the city to try to do stuff are going to be penalized by it. And that
exactly.
bothers me. But that's politics, and I don't tend to do that. So.
And the big one that I always go back to is the carbon emissions. Yeah, the batteries cause a lot of carbon emissions, but it's not continuously causing carbon emissions by using the vehicle itself.
Yeah, no, there was a time where all we cared about was hydrocarbons and carbon monoxide, and now we care about CO2, which, you know, CO2 was the, you know, I used to call it the happy gas. No one cared about it. And then all of a sudden they found out CO2 adds to global warming. The problem is sort of the same thing. It's like, yeah, batteries, you know, there is that kind of deep, dark secret of batteries that they're hard to recycle. although they're almost 100% recyclable, lithium ion is a tricky thing to recycle. And the other thing is some of the power plants that are used to make electricity and other things are not that clean, but they pay a tax to be dirty. The best way to make hydrogen, for instance, the best way to make electricity is with nuclear. But who wants that reactor in your backyard?
Exactly.
Yeah. Anyway, enough of this kind of stuff. Let's talk to Rick. Rick, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Well, good.
Well, let me first make a comment, then I'll give you my question. My comment is, I like pumps that are full, especially on my motorcycle, so you don't splash gas outside the tank.
Well, that is true, but you can be careful. You know, you can pump slow. I had a diesel pickup truck that I was driving, and of course it had like a 50-gallon tank, I was amazed how much faster the diesel pumps pump because why? You're pumping, 150 gallons of diesel into a tractor trailer, so you want something that pumps pretty fast. I can understand with a motorcycle how you'd want to pump slow and not fill all the way up to the top so it doesn't slosh around when you go to put the cap back on. So, yeah, I can understand that.
Yeah. Now, here's the question. The other day I was driving down a road and it was almost like I was driving through smoke. There was so much dust from the salt they put down. Now, we all know what salt does to the outside of the car, but what effect does it have on the engine, getting into the air filter and such?
That's why you need to change your air filter and such, because air filter and cabin filters, it's kind of funny. It's there is almost every manufacturer has a very specific interval to change air filters and if your car has a cabin filter. And it will say change it more often if you drive on dusty dirt roads. The problem, and here in Massachusetts, we don't have a lot of dusty dirt roads, but we do have pollen. We do have salt dust and sand dust when they do the roads. And, after they put all that stuff on the roads and it dries out, it ends up making, like you said, a cloud. And that's why, people say to me, well, how often do I change those filters? And I said, well, if you looked at the owner's manual, it says change it at 30,000 miles. You change it when it's dirty. So you pull it out, you tap it, you tap on the side of it, knock anything out of it that's in it, and then either put it back in or put a new one in. So it will, that salt dust, sand dust, which I guess is just dust, and pollen and other stuff that's floating in the air can certainly clog up an air filter and a cabin filter. My wife's car has an air filter and a cabin filter in her Volkswagen, and each time it went to the dealer, the dealer said, well, you ought to think about replacing those filters. And they did it based on just how old the car was. So they wanted to replace it at a year old, and then they wanted to replace it. They wanted to replace it at 2 years old and at 3 years old. And I said, and she said, no, my husband will change it when it needs to be changed. And I actually ordered them from Rock Auto, and I ordered the exact same German manufacturer filters. So they were exactly the same ones that Volkswagen used right from the factory, only they didn't say Volkswagen. They just said the name brand on them, which also is what it said on the factory filter. And put it in the cars. And neither of them were really that dirty. That was the funny thing. They were both pretty clean. So they were doing it just based on time. They didn't even do it based on looking at the filters and seeing whether they were dirty or not. They just said, hey, the filters are 3 years old and the owner's manual says to change them, when in fact they weren't really dirty at all. So, so you're right, Rick. Salt and sand can clog up a filter. It can get dirty. So that's why when cars go in for oil changes, it's not a bad idea to pop out the air filter and see what kind of shape it's in and see if it needs to be changed or not.
Well, I live in Massachusetts, and my home, when I first bought it, was on a dirt road.
Yeah, but now they paved it, and now they probably plow it.
No, we paved it.
Oh, you paved it. Okay. Well, I also sort of live on a dirt road in Massachusetts, and but it's and it gets pretty dusty. So
Yeah.
So, but it's only you know, it's only 1,000 feet long. So it's I'm not driving in that much dust. But it does. But you know, it is funny that you know you do have to consider all those things. And pollen is one of the ones that nobody really thinks of. How many times have you driven through a cloud of pollen, and you think about your engine air cleaner, and air intake is like a giant vacuum cleaner. It's sucking in air as fast as you drive, and it's literally sucking up the air. And it's kind of funny. Mercedes and Volvo, I think, the air that goes into the climate control system and the air that comes into the tailpipe, they claim that because of the filtering systems and so forth, comes out cleaner on the other side. Well, where's all the contaminants go? It ends up in the filters.
Well, actually, if it makes it past the filter, does it do any damage to the engine?
At that point, my guess is it's so small it wouldn't make any difference. That would be my guess.
Curiosity question.
Yeah. That would be my guess. Now, if somehow you, I don't know, got it wet somehow, and maybe you got a little bit of, we'll say, salty liquid, but I don't think so. And that's why, for instance, you change your oil periodically. But if you drove 1,000 miles, say you were driving from, I guess that's not quite 1,000. You were driving from your house to Flint, Michigan, and it had snowed the entire way, and they sand and salted the roads, every road you drove on. Probably wouldn't do any damage to the engine, but could the filter be dirty by the time you got there? Maybe. Could be. And that's why sometimes you need to...
doing almost that today, so...
Oh, is she?
Yeah.
Well, tell her to be careful.
Yeah, I did. She says I'm an old lady.
All right, well, Rick, so that's the best I can come up with for an answer, I guess.
Okay, it was just one of those questions that popped into my mind.
Hey, it's the same kind of questions that pop into my mind all the time. So
yeah,
there you go. Yep. All right, thanks, Rick. Our phone lines are open at 617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. Why don't you give us a call? Make Dennis earn his $3.40 an hour. We need to take a break and pay some bills. We'll be right back. And welcome back to the Car Doctor program on AM 950 WROL. And for and Dennis probably knows this, but is that the first time that the term heavy metal was ever mentioned?
Yes.
Sort of like metal rock?
Yes.
So
in
that song.
That's considered the first heavy metal song, but what they're actually referencing is their motorcycles.
I know, but that's about all I know about music. That's it. So, you know, you get what you get. So,
and
617, go ahead.
I was going to say, John from Quincy dropped off the line, so all we have is Tom.
All right. So if you would like to join us and you don't want to wait, 617-770-3030 is the number. Let's talk to Tom. Tom, good morning.
Yeah, hi, John. Looks like the subject of the day is electric cars, huh?
Sometimes.
Hey, I got a question. You may have already discussed this in length, and I missed it, but kind of like the elephant in the room is the how do they heat these things up in the winter on days like this? When you're climbing your car, it's been at work sitting outside for like 8 hours. I can understand at home, most of these people afford a $40,000 car, they got a heated garage, but how do they, have to design from the ground up some super efficient heater? How does it work, you know?
Yes, some of it does actually work. It sort of works like a heat pump sort of thing, so like an electric heat pump in a house. So it does have coolant that gets hot. The older electric cars actually had a regular heating grid, which wasn't very efficient. You turn the heat on and the battery would drop to nothing.
That's what I was thinking ahead. Yeah.
But the new ones actually heat coolant. With the electric motor, so that's what warms it up. And when they're plugged in, you can take advantage. You can actually set a timer you know, 15 minutes before you get in the car, and it will actually warm the car up while it's plugged in. So that's sort of it. But the other thing is we've done some testing at AAA on. You know, everybody assumes that in cold weather, you're going to lose a certain percent of your range.
Yeah.
And that is true. But also in hot weather, too. We put a lot of current. Well, not even that. Just the temperature affects the battery. So out at the AAA office in California, they have a regular EPA-certified four-wheel engine chassis dynamometer. So we put a Tesla on it. We chilled the room down to about 25 degrees. And where that Tesla might have normally gone 250 miles between charges, it dropped to about 170. And then they cranked up the heat to about 95 degrees or 100 degrees, and that 250 miles dropped to about 200. So temperature in its own can affect range too. So that's one of them. So electric cars, you know, they have some challenges here and there, but they're also, you know, they're also kind of unique, and it's kind of funny. I saw an advertisement from 1969 Motor Trend magazine, and the title on it says steam, electric, turbine, or gas could be the car of the future. So way back in 1969, which to me doesn't seem that long ago, they said you know, it could be cars of the future, whenever the future could be, because it shows a guy sitting in something that looks like a Formula One style car, but it uses a bunch of Autolite batteries, and the thing could go 138 miles an hour, and it went on Bonneville Salt Flats. But the idea, you know, and I've said this for years, that, you know, back in, you know, the 1900s, you could buy a car that ran on gasoline, you could buy a car that ran on diesel, you could buy a car that ran on batteries, you know, Baker Electric was one, or you could, you know, or ran on, I don't know, wood chips and I don't know, something else, you know. I guess you could actually buy a car that, or not buy it, but technically you could somehow make it run on manure, and I don't know, I don't even want to know how that worked.
It's not to say it can't be a problem because people are buying them left and right, and it's not an issue apparently, but I often wonder how they did that, and I suppose you can write off 20% of the range. and that's the name of that game, but that doesn't discourage people from buying them because they're definitely the manufacturers are putting billions of dollars into the Volkswagen and so forth.
You know, I would rather, I will say though, I would much rather see the manufacturers put billions of dollars into electric cars than billions of dollars put into self-driving cars.
Because
most of the public doesn't really want self-driving cars.
I don't care. It's not an interesting subject, and I just don't care.
And it's always in the back of your mind.
Yeah. What if something goes wrong, man? You're gone. Yeah. I know you have to keep the controllers and so forth, but I don't get it.
What's the point of having a self-driving car that you have to drive?
If you have to sit there
posed over the steering wheel, I want to be able to take a nap.
I know, and all that money, I don't get it myself. But real quick, I might have told you this before. Electric cars. This tells a big story. This past summer, I went to a car show in Bedford area, Deerhead or something. I don't know who they were. Good car show, typical. Cars lined up, hoods up, and beautiful engines and stuff. Guy parks his Model 3 at the end of the line with a hood up. I think he was just trying to be a clown, you know? Not fantasy, but there it is. That speaks
there it is, yeah.
Nothing to look at. No beautiful engine with chrome all over it and so forth and so on, you know, the street rods and stuff. And he parks his red Model 3 there with a hood up. And it was so funny.
Yeah. Now, the ones I will give, you know, the hot rodders credit, I saw a video of a guy who took an Audi, I think it was like an Audi A4 or something, and he actually put a Tesla drivetrain in it. So it was pretty unique because it was, you know, here's something you expected to have a gasoline engine in.
Yeah.
You know, it was like the first time I ever opened the hood of a Miata and saw a 302 V8 in it, the 5-liter V8 in it, and said, "Wow, look at that!" Yeah. Same thing with the Audi A4 with a Tesla motor and battery pack crammed in it somewhere, and you know, just the idea that somebody did it. There's always going to be hot rodders. There's always going to be people to try to make cars lighter and faster, and I like that.
Me too.
I also like them when they make a little bit of noise too. So,
exactly. Yeah. Okay, John. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. All right. Take care.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
617-770-3030 is the phone number. I was just looking at an ad for AMSOIL, the very first in synthetics. It says here, your bearings shoulder the burden whenever you tow, haul, or stomp on the gas. AMSOIL delivers powerful protection. I remember talking to the original founder of AMSOIL. It had to be 30 years ago, and he looked at, you know, they measured scar diameter, and they're still kind of promoting that. Testing conducted in independent laboratories using AMSOIL Signature Series 5W30 synthetic oil against a leading brand of 5W30 synthetic oil in a Ford F-150 with twin turbos. And it does show that over time, you're going to get a little bit of more wear and tear on bearings and none with AMSOIL. So pretty good product. Expensive, and you buy it like from the Fuller Brush guy. You buy it from the independent AMSOIL salesperson, and just kind of interesting that they're, you know, it's been around for that long, and people are still using it. 617-770-3030 is our number. I think we have Mike in Hingham. Good morning.
Good morning, Carl.
Hey, how are you?
Mike here.
Hey, how are you? Good.
Very good. Well, trying to stay warm. Hey, got a quick question. I'm a big Lexus fan, and I just got yesterday's Consumer Reports in the March issue. It says cars owners love and hate, and I'm absolutely flabbergasted that, let me give you three examples.
Okay.
They list luxury compact cars, Lexus dead last. They say ultra luxury cars like the Genesis G90 and the Tulsa S, Lexus dead last. Sporty cars, Lexus RC, dead last. And then they go into luxury vehicles, actually second from last. What the hell's happened to Lexus? Is this just a bad issue, or are you seeing any problems with them at all, or what the heck's going on?
Genesis
paying them off?
Well, I don't think they're doing that. You know, as much as sometimes I question Consumer Reports, and it's funny, I I was at an event and my boss was there, and there was a woman from Consumer Reports, and she walked over and I had met her before. My boss didn't realize that, and she introduced herself, and I said, and he said, you know, I won't even think about buying a car before I look at Consumer Reports. And I looked at him and her, and I said, you know, they're just a bunch of white coated toaster testers. What do they know about cars? And he's like, oh, that was pretty harsh. And I said, no, I'm only kidding, because the person who for years and years, for 20 years, ran the auto lab at Consumer Reports referred to himself as a white-coated toaster tester, and they actually put a bunch of toasters on their test track, and they all wore white coats, and that's where that came from. I think, you know, Lexus, I think when I, Lexus, the original LS Lexus, the 400,
right.
Consumer Reports would even say that was the car they judged every other luxury car from, because it was solid, dependable. Lexus is one of those companies that it's, you know, and I remember I stole this line from somebody else, but they are truly the belt and suspender company. They, you know, they don't just put one system in, they run redundant systems for everything.
Yeah.
So if something fails, it's still going to perform the way it's supposed to. I think what's hurt Lexus a little bit is their cars have gotten a little bit boring. What did they put? You mentioned the categories that Lexus was dead last in. What was at the top of that list?
Yeah, let me go grab that page again. So
yeah.
It was, for example, like on the IS was the Telsa 3, then the Kia Stinger, kind of give you an idea.
Okay.
On the ultra luxury was a G90 and a Telsa Model S and the Mercedes and a BMW 7.
Yep.
On the sporty cars was a 911, the Corvette, and the Challenger. But, I mean, ahead of Lexus RC was a Mini Coupe. You got to be kidding me.
Yeah, well,
I mean,
you know, let's back up to that, you know, the category with the Corvette and the, you know, Corvette's a great car, no question. Porsche 911, great car. You know, the Lexus is, you know, maybe some people can consider it not quite as, you know, not quite as powerful for the money, you know, in the IS version. The IS is a great car, you know, but people say, is it as good as a, you know, BMW 3 Series? You know, when they look at cars that owners love and hate, some of it has to do with sort of the passion of the car. The Kia Stinger is a fantastic car, but
right. It
rides a little too hard. They have the suspension cranked up just a little too hard. It's a little too firm, but it's also one of those cars that is truly a surprise. You get in the car and you're like, wow, this thing's a Kia, really? And the same thing with the Genesis. You know, let's face it, they had to change the name from Hyundai to Genesis to get people to buy them, because people are like, I don't know if I want to buy a $60,000-$70,000 Hyundai. So we'll call it a Genesis, and maybe people kind of forget that it's really a Hyundai. They're great cars. They're absolutely great cars. And the difference between the big Genesis, which is a really good car, and the big Mercedes, which is a really good car, is about $30,000 difference in price. Now, the people who look at that stuff really closely will say, yeah, it's $30,000 difference in price, but if you look really close, there's $30,000 difference in car. But you have to look really, really close at things, where the Genesis might use a little bit of plastic here and there, where the Mercedes might use aluminum. You know, even if you looked at, you know, if you looked at ultra luxury, you look at a Rolls Royce or a Bentley, and you look at the wood, and you it's all match grain wood. It's, you know, the veneer is, you know, is better than anything you'd find on a piece of furniture. And that's why you pay for it. But I think when it comes to cars that consumers, it's not, let's face it, and like you said, you're a Lexus, you love your Lexus. And, you know, and you would tell people, you know, it's the only car you should buy is a Lexus because you really like it. And that's what happens. You talk to people that own Mini Coopers, they love their Mini Cooper. They're in the shop once a month, but they love their Mini Cooper.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so
I, I'm looking at it right here. It says Chevy Camaro got an 81 score, and something called a Lexus RC, which I'm not familiar with, got a 58.
And the Lexus RC is, you know, that was Lexus's attempt at a sports car kind of thing. And I drove one, and I drove the I drove the RC350, so the smaller engine version. It was a interesting looking car, but it was, for somebody who was looking for a sports car, kind of, it might have been a little bit of a disappointment. But, you know, still, if you had to compare, you know, when you look at cars like this, you have to look at, you know, how dependable is it? You know, in my life of owning cars, the car that was the most fun I ever owned was an MGB. It was the worst car I ever owned. But if somebody said to me,
Yeah, exactly.
So it was like, I got to meet more people while I was broken down by the side of the road. But it was fun to drive. It seemed pretty fast. You put the top down, and it was like, oh, I love that car. Did I love that car in the rain when I had to like reassemble the top in a rainstorm? No. It was, but you know, you look back, and even if you look back at old Volkswagens, people are like, oh, I lived the Volkswagen Microbus. It was such a great car. It blew over in windstorms, and you couldn't go up steep hills. So people they fall in love with the car they own, and sometimes they buy a car and they go, you know, I bought this Lexus because it was a great car. I got an email this morning from a woman who's hasn't bought a car in 12 years since she bought a Honda Pilot, and she decided she wants to buy something smaller and more fun. So she's looking at a BMW 2 Series and an Audi A3. Both great cars. She's thinking about buying a convertible. Fantastic cars, but she also says, I keep my car 12 to 15 years. A BMW 2 Series and an Audi A3, as nice as cars as they are, when they start to go out of warranty, you got to start to put the same amount of payment money aside to pay for the repairs. They handle good, they perform well. And I also kind of in my response back to her said, you're going from a good size SUV to a small, relatively impractical, fun to drive little car. Take it overnight, go to the grocery store with it and find out if you can put your groceries in it. Because it may not, you know, so you may buy it and say, I love this car. Well, I don't like it when I go on vacation because I can only put one suitcase in it.
I understand. I agree. I mean, looking outside. My wife has a 2004 LS430 with 75,000 miles on it. I would drive it to San Francisco this afternoon.
Is that reliable?
Hey, I'll let you go. But one last thing is, I'm gonna read right now. Ask the Car Doctor. Should I buy a 2019 Santa Fe? That's my next job in life.
There you go.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much. Take care.
Bye bye. Well, at least I know I'm in the Boston Globe today. So, should I buy a 2019 Santa Fe? It has all the bells and whistles in it. Didn't do that well in Consumer Reports or one of the magazines. I'm driving a 2017 Hyundai Santa Fe Sport, very similar to mine, and it's a year older. It's got 10 times the mileage on it that mine does, and it seems to be holding up pretty well, I might say. Where are we going, Dennis? Mike in Bridgewater?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's go to Mike in Bridgewater. Michael?
Yes, good morning, John.
Good morning. I think the last three callers were all Mike, weren't they?
It's a triple.
I guess.
Tom, Mike, and Mike.
Mike. Okay, yeah.
Hey, Mike,
okay.
All right, maybe that's a law firm. Anyway, yeah. Good morning again. Warranty question for you, please.
Sure.
What I'm getting on the dashboard is maintenance required, see the dealer. And you get that message. But then when you go to the actual thing that looks like a little wrench, I still have about 5,000 miles until they do the next oil change.
Okay.
Can you tell me what is the difference in that, and does it have any effect on a warranty if you don't do the in-between the 10,000 oil change kind of thing? Do you know?
Yeah. What happens is it's all – what kind of car is it?
It's a Lexus. It's a ES hybrid.
Yeah, okay. And it may be, see, the way that's set up, there's there's all little parameters that come up that it might mean that, you know, there's a 10,000 mile in between oil changes, but there might be a 6,000 miles in between tire rotations. So you don't really know why it's telling you to go in.
Yes, I know. And as you have said before, when you go into the dealership, you know, it's not $10 and thank you for stopping by and a cup of coffee.
No. Yeah, exactly. So, for instance, I think I was looking at my wife's car, and it has, you can go into the menu, and it says, oh, maybe it was my own car. It was my own car. And you can go into the menu, and it's like, and you can set, like, they had it set for oil changes every 3,500 miles. They had it set for tire rotations every 6,000 miles. And they had it set for something else every 10,000 miles. Well,
okay.
I don't necessarily agree with that. Because they had the maintenance all set for severe maintenance schedules. And so all it really does is, you know, comes on maintenance required, not a check engine light, not anything broken, but it just says maintenance required. And that maintenance required tells you, well, you need to go in and do something to the car because they want you to come back to the dealership to spend some money on it. But you don't know really what it is. So there should be a way to go into the menu to see what is actually required at that little, why that little wrench came up. But chances are it's something like, you know, a filter change or a tire rotation or some other kind of very generic sort of thing.
Okay. And my question, I guess, is if you don't do that, is there an impact on the warranty? You know, because it's still under warranty. It's a 2016, so I still have a little bit left. And I just want to know, if you don't do that, because, you know, the maintenance minder comes up, but you still have the wrench tells you you've still got 5,000 miles till the synthetic oil change. So
yeah.
I get maybe the oil change. I understand that.
Right.
But
yeah,
if you don't do the...
Yeah. My gut says there shouldn't be any difference. You know, it should be that if it's under warranty, it's under warranty as long as you do the maintenance that is prescribed with the car. So this is where I would take the owner's manual out, look in the owner's manual and say that you have, you know, 30,000 miles on the car, whatever's on it, and look in the owner's manual and see what should be done at 30,000 miles. Because you may find that some of what's coming up with the maintenance reminder is a little artificial, where the owner's manual is going to say, well, based on your style of driving or whatever you do, That's when you do what has to be done.
Okay.
So
when I've looked, I'm sorry.
Yeah. So I mean, there's one thing to say: we're not going to cover it under warranty because you didn't do the cooling system service, or we're not going to cover it under warranty because you didn't do oil changes, or they're going to cover it under things are going to be covered under warranty if an air filter's dirty. Things are going to be covered under warranty if your tires didn't get rotated. Things are going to be covered under warranty if someone didn't open the hood and just check all the fluids. So, you know, there's plenty of room for a little bit of flexibility in there. So,
okay,
yeah,
all right, yeah. You know what it is. You get that minder, and you have to physically turn it off all the time. So
right.
You know, it's kind of there all the time. And you kind of forget about it, but then you go back and say, because what I found when I've looked in the owner's manuals, you find that middle thing, it gets done at the, you know, the oil change
right.
Anyways. So that's why I was kind of thinking, wait till the oil change.
I would go into the menu for that and see if it can see in the display if it can actually come up what that little indicator is for. You might have to go deep into the digital display on the system to try to come up with an answer for it.
Okay, I will. Then if I may just quickly change the subject.
Yep,
on
sure.
Personal note, how's your infestation? You okay over there with the missus?
So far,
I didn't know if you were on baseball bat duty late to the night, so okay.
So far, so good. You know, we'll be heading home soon, but it's, who knew there was such a thing as fruit rats and, you know, everything in Florida wants to kill you, you know, so, Yeah, so it's but you know, we have a perimeter set up all around the house now. So
you're victorious, John.
Yeah. We hope so.
Until they see you leave and they say, okay, the coast is clear.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Enjoy the show. Have a good one.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I think we need to take another break, pay some bills. My name is John Paul. This is the Car Doctor Program. If you want to give us a call, 617-770-3030. We'll be right back.
She's real fine, my 409, my 409. Well, I save my pennies and I save my dimes.
Well, I left Kentucky back in 49 and went to Detroit working on assembly line. The first year they had me putting wheels on Cadillacs. Every day I'd watch them beauties roll by and sometimes I'd hang my head and cry, 'cause I always wanted me one that was long and black. One day I devised myself a plan that should be the envy of most any man. I'd sneak it out of there in a lunchbox in my hand.
And welcome back to the Car Doctor Program on AM 950 WROL, the Spirit of Boston. Maybe you're listening on 100.3 FM or the app, as Johnny Costello would say, tap the app. You can listen to us. You can put your phone in your pocket. You can listen with headphones. You can stream it live. You can do whatever you want. Smartphones are pretty smart, except for my wife's smartphone that apparently has a virus that something is seizing the home screen, and I haven't figured out how to come up with that. So if there's any brilliant people out there that know how to fix that kind of thing, drop me an email, because I've tried all the online fixes and none of them seem to work, but I don't know. Let's talk to Peter in Salem. Peter? Peter?
Hello, John.
Hello, Peter. So, building a Cadillac one part at a time, is that a little like having an Edsel?
Same thing, John, but one was built in Detroit and one was built in Somerville, Mass.
That's right, but I was just thinking that, you know, did a 58 use all 58 parts?
They used a lot of Ford Mercury stuff and a lot of Edsel trim and...
Yeah, that's what... Well, it's funny, I was out for a ride yesterday, and I saw a Pontiac pickup truck. Now, of course, there's no such thing as a Pontiac pickup truck, but it was if I had to guess at the year, I would say it was mid-40s, maybe a 46 or 7 Pontiac that someone kind of cut in half and grafted a Chevy pickup truck bed on the back of it. So it was this pretty interesting looking combination of Pontiac pickup truck, and I looked at it and I went, well, I'm pretty sure they never made one of those. And it was very well done, whoever did it. So always fun to see interesting stuff.
Yeah. Well, now you're down in the sunny south. You can go to Winter Haven this winter and see the annual Edsel meet.
I'm only down here for hours left, so not much longer. So yeah, you know, someday if I ever retire, it would be nice to be able to say, you know, I could spend the warm weather months in Massachusetts and the cold weather months in Florida, but we haven't figured that part out yet. So
step by step. John, yeah. I have a question.
Yes, sir.
My 2013 Honda Accord, the passenger side, I got two flats at various times. Front tire was patched. Rear tire was patched. I'm going in for an oil change, and a lot of times they want to rotate the tires.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is good. Should I leave it as is and forget the rotation, or rotate and hopefully they don't break?
No, there should be. I mean, if they were patched properly, it shouldn't be. There shouldn't be any issues whatsoever.
Okay.
The right way to patch a tire is a patch and a plug combination. So there's a sort of a plug that fills the hole and a patch that seals the liner on the inside of the tire. So once they're repaired. Unless, you know, if you said to me, I have a Porsche 911 with, you know, 180 mile an hour tires on it, what happens is sometimes on those, depending on the manufacturer, if you repair a tire, it lowers the speed rating. So they're not rated for the same high speed that they were before. But the tires on your Honda are probably maybe HR rated, so whatever the equivalent is now. And it's not going to change the speed rating, and you're not going to be driving at 120 plus miles an hour, you know,
on a
consistent basis. So it's not going to matter. So you can think nothing of rotating the tires and driving to California afterwards. It's fine.
Okay. All right. I just, you know what they say, if it works, don't fix it.
Yeah.
And it's going good right now. So
but there's no reason when you look at a properly repaired tire. You know, if you said to me, you know, they repaired the tire and the hole was, you know, it was kind of in the sidewall, but the guy tried to save me some money and he patched it and he said it might not last. Then I'd be worried about it. If it was just you got unlucky and you ran over a nail and it was somewhere between the middle of the tread and they fixed it and it's good to go and never worry about it.
Okay. Cause the one in the rear, John, it was kind of close to the sidewall.
But as long as it wasn't in the sidewall, it's fine.
No, close
yep,
to.
No.
No.
Okay. No, you're fine. You're
all
good.
Right, John.
Okay. All right.
Very good.
Take care, Peter.
You'll be here for the warm up. We're gonna get the warm up soon.
Well, that's what I understand. So my wife is hoping, you know, that, you know, flights get canceled and she has to stay. So.
Well, that, John, that's a good sign. because it's working. Right.
Yeah. I gotta go home and pay some bills. So.
Oh. Yeah. All right, John.
All thanks. Right.
As always, thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
617-770-3030, 617-770-3030. I think we have time for one more call if you want to call in and chat about what's going on in your life with cars before we talk to our buddy Paul Sullivan. There's a story about the original Beetle billed as the people's car because of its practical small size and value price. It was one of those cars that, you know, everyone liked it, I think. New York importer Max Hoffman in 1950 signed on as Volkswagen's exclusive dealer and agent for the U.S. east of the Mississippi River. Hoffman also was a distributor of other European makes such as Jaguar, BMW, and Porsche. His Park Ave showroom was legendary as he managed to sell 157 Beetles. Dealers found that they could get their hands on more popular marks if they agreed to take a few of Hoffman's Volkswagen models too. But dealers soon discovered the low-priced Volkswagens were better sellers than the higher-priced imports. The Type 1 was officially given the name Beetle in 1968, sparked by Beetlemania. It went on to become popular among U.S. suburbanites in post-war America and later a symbol of counterculture in the 60s. On February 17, 1972, Beetle number 15 million rolled off the assembly line, surpassing the record held by the Model T for four decades as the top-selling car worldwide. It sold in the United States from 1950 to 1979 and revived and updated in 1998. And it was funny. People who live in Quincy area may have seen Volkswagens a little bit later because Harvey Kurtzman was importing some Mexican Beetles at the time. And he was doing some of the EPA and DOT conversions to them and selling them. And, you know, Harvey's still around. I talked to him, I don't know, a year or so ago. But he always had something going on and some little deal he had. I know he had $1 million worth of old Volkswagen parts tucked away somewhere. But, yeah, they were around. And it was an interesting car. It's kind of sad to see it go. Let's talk to Paul in Somerville. Paul, good morning.
Good morning, John. How you doing?
Good.
I got a question for you. I'm looking at upgrading the headlights in my 2011 Ford Explorer. I went to one place and headlights and fog lights, they said $650. Does that sound really out of whack?
Well, I think I would start with a small upgrade first and see how, you know, that sounds like they're putting HID conversions in. So they're replacing our LED conversions in. I might go to sort of something a little simpler first, maybe something like a Sylvania, you know, Silver Star Plus or GE Nighthawk or something that the bulbs are $50 or $60 maybe, and see how much better they seem than the original ones. If you go, the problem is to do a legal HID conversion, which is quite expensive, like you saw, which is about right. They also, to be completely legal, have to be self-leveling. So depending on how fussy the next state inspection you go to, they might look at them and go, oh, these aren't the right lights. And they could literally make you take the lights out and put the factory ones back in. So you want to make sure that you have some certificate that says they're a legal DOT conversion to make sure that they're done right. But you could also just go a slight upgrade to a slightly brighter, whiter bulb, which may get a little bit more light on the road.
Yeah, I think right now the halogens they're okay, but...
They're okay. And you could go, like I said, you could go to a brighter halogen. They're not going to last as long. That's the other downside is. The LED, one of the things you have to watch out with the LED conversions is, Hyundai has terrible backup lights. So I'm going to do LED conversions to the backup lights to get a little bit more light on the road to back up. And you have to make sure that depending on how the car is wired, sometimes you'll do these replacement lights. You have to put a kit in to make sure you don't have a check engine light come on afterwards because it all runs on this computer network bus. And it thinks that there's a headlight out because they don't draw the same amount of amperage as the factory lights do. So you have to make sure you're going to some place where they know what they're doing.
Is this something like a place like Auto Toys can handle?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So maybe just give Dave a call at Auto Toys and just, talk to him and, kind of tap his brain a little bit. And, even if you don't use him, get some ideas from, what he thinks is the right thing to do based on your model. He does quite a few of those.
That sounds good. All right. Thanks,
okay.
John.
All right. Thanks.
All right.
Well, we are almost out of time, but our buddy, Paul Sullivan, is in the studio. Sully, good morning.
I'm not talking to you
Why?
Because you're in Florida and I'm very jealous and envious right now.
Well, I live a very simple life. You know, I'm here in my tiny tin house, made out of tin.
Yeah.
What's
the temperature down there, Mr. Paul?
It claims to be in the sun, and it's been cold. It's been winter down here.
Raining because we have some friends that have been lamenting that fact over the last week.
Last week we got about 5 inches of rain in one day.
Yeah.
But it's according to my little indoor outdoor thermometer in the sun right now, it's 82 degrees.
Well, again, it's 13 here, Dennis?
If that.
There you are, exactly.
But that's in the sun, I haven't had breakfast yet, and this is where I sound obnoxious. I'm going to go out and pick a tangerine off the tree.
You sound obnoxious.
<I know>.
Not only that, I was joking to Dennis that, you're talking about needing a brighter backup light in your vehicle. I don't even know what the backup light in my vehicle is. I paid no attention. I couldn't tell you if it was even on. And
well,
that's why you're you and I'm me.
But, you have a better microphone than I do, so.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
My backup microphone goes like this, beep, 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 beep.
So what do you got going on today for the Irish Hit Parade? And by the way, I understand you were celebrating your grandson's birthday last week?
Yeah, we drove down to Washington, Claire, and me and her two sisters, and we celebrated the Zachary Sullivan, the big, how you say the big 5-0? Well, Zach's the big five, so.
The big five,
yeah.
Exactly. And also helping out with the Irish Hit Parade, I heard him do a little promo.
We put him to work, yes, early
That's
in his
right.
family. And
it's,
he takes direction well. He did a nice job.
Yeah, he did. He did a really nice job.
He's a good kid. We're blessed. And, it's good. What really is bad is that they're 500 miles away because they both work in the district. And, and they're happy, but we'd like our grandson to be a little bit closer. And so we get down there whenever we can.
Yeah, it makes perfect. And are they following your kindergarten advice, by the way?
Well, yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Cause, for people who are on Twitter, follow Paul on Twitter, his, 66 Moons Twitter handle, because, you put some very insightful things in there.
Well, I've been in the game for a while. So if anybody can benefit from things that I've learned and somehow even now take for granted, I love that it's very gratifying if somebody says, hey, what you said there relaxed me, eased my mind, made me feel like I wasn't abusing my child.
So you don't think a 4-year-old should be taking trigonometry lessons?
It's funny. I was listening to the radio the other day, and I heard an ad for a wonderful kindergarten. I taught multiplication in kindergarten, and I tweeted out something to say, that's good if you're going to learn the quadratic equation in first grade, or more likely to calculate the therapist bills that are going to be in your future from being so stressed out to learn multiplication in kindergarten.
Yeah. Let kids be kids and let them learn how to interact with other kids.
There's
right?
no reason that a 5-year-old needs to know how to multiply. And if you're boasting that your program is better because the kids in it do that, then your program's not that good.
The only thing they need to learn how to do is if there's three cookies and four kids, how to split them up.
Exactly.
Yeah, simple enough.
And because we don't have the huge families that, I have seven siblings. But you don't have families of that size anymore. So once kids get to school, it really is they're breaking in, learning to be with other people. And that's really, really important. That's where the rubber meets the road.
There you go.
Yep.
There you go. Look at that segue of automotive talk.
I know. That's
rubber
why I did it.
Road.
I thought
there
that
you
out.
Go. There you go.
I have written down here, right here. Say this.
The piano guy's playing in the background, which means Paul Sullivan and the very best in Irish music is coming up right now with the Irish Hit Parade. Until next week, make sure you wear your seatbelt, drive safely, and be good to your car. Talk to you all next week. Bye-bye.